Hello, welcome back to the presentation on Mechanics of Materials. This is an initiative under VTU eShikshana program. In module 5, columns, this is lecture 2. In previous lecture, we studied about the types of columns, classification of columns, where the columns are used, and in various construction related applications and in mechanical applications where the columns can be employed, and how to design the column for the safe operation of the structure. Now, to just refresh the things, in the previous class, we studied about the types of columns for different end conditions, where you can see here, the different end conditions are, the first one, you can see the column here, the column normally is a vertical member subjected to compressive loads. You can see the column here, a vertical column. Now the line indicates it is a member before the application of load. And when the load is applied, if the column buckles, then it is nothing but the failure of the column. So to avoid this buckling, we need to design the columns for safe operation. Now the different types of end conditions are, you can see here, one is both ends pinned. So if both the ends are pinned and or hinged, it can also be called as hinged. So the effective length is the length for which the entire column buckles, that is the effective length. This is one condition, that is both ends pinned or hinged. You can see in the other diagram also, where you can see both the ends are pinned or hinged. Then the effective length is taken for the part which has been buckled under the application of load. Second is both ends fixed. You can see here, both the ends are fixed. Both the ends are fixed here. And the third condition is one end is fixed and other end is free. So this is the fixed end and the other end is free to the deflect. And the third fourth condition is one end fixed and the other end is hinged. So one end is fixed and the other end is hinged. So effective length is the length for which the column buckles. So you can see here the effective lengths for different conditions, end conditions. One, the effective length in the first case, you can see here, is equal to the actual length of the column. And in the second case, it is due to the deflection, the effective length is equal to twice the actual length of the column. And in the third case, the effective length is half of the actual length. And the portion of this L by 4 and L by 4 is not affected, and only this part is subjected to the buckling. And the fourth case, one end fixed and other end is hinged, the effective length is L by square root of 2. So these are the different end conditions in the applications of columns. And you can see on the other diagram also, the same has been shown in the different diagrams here. So these are the effective lengths, the empirical formula to calculate the effective length in different end conditions. Now coming to the sign conventions for bending moment, you can see here, if the column bending takes place as shown in figure, So you can see here, if the column bending takes place as shown in this figure in the form of a convex shape, you can see here, if it is in the convexity is appearing in the shape of the column, then it is taken as the positive value. And otherwise, if the column bending is taking place or taking a shape of convex shape as shown here, then the value is taken as negative. So this sign convention is followed in calculating the bending moment in case of columns, in designing the columns for effective service. So now this Euler's for deriving the safe buckling load or critical load, Euler has developed the equations. He has derived the equations, and he has derived the equations for four different conditions. That is, one, both ends hinged or pinned. Second, both ends fixed. third one end fixed, other end is pinned, and the fourth case, that is one end fixed free and the other end is fixed. So let us see one by one each case and how the equation for critical load is derived. So you can see here, so in the first case, the Euler's crippling load is nothing but the critical load for a column when both ends are hinged or pinned. In the diagram, you can see the dotted line, this indicates the column, the application of load, you can see. So let us take AB is the column, and due to the application of load, there is a deflection in the column, and column AB of length L hinged at both ends, A and B. When a load P is applied at end B, the column deflects through a distance Y. You can see here, it deflects through a distance of Y. At the neutral axis, we have taken the deflection, and it is at a distance of X from one of the ends. Now, the bending moment at XX is the axis, neutral axis. So Y is the length of the column. So then if I take the bending moment, it is equal to minus into P into Y, negative sign because it is taking concave shape. So that is why negative sign is included here. Load into the distance or the length. So negative sign because of concavity of the shape of the column. And now this can be written in the form of EI into D square Y by DX square, which is equal to minus PX into Y, where E is the Young's modulus, I is the moment of inertia. So the same equation can be further written as EI into D square Y by DX square plus PY is equal to zero, or D square Y by DX square plus P into Y by EI is equal to zero. So let us take this as equation one. Now we can write the general equation, differential equation solution for this equation number one, which can be written as Y is equal to A cos X square root of P by EI plus B sin X root P by EI. And now this is the solution for the above equation one, where A and B are the constants of integration. So now applying the boundary condition, we can solve for these values A and B. So the first boundary condition, you can see when X is equal to L, you can see when X is L, that is total length, then there is no deflection, Y is equal to zero, okay? Then if we substitute this in the equation, we can see Y is equal to zero, then this is, if you substitute here, X is equal to L, Y is equal to zero, we are supplying as the boundary condition. So then we'll get from this equation, B sine L square root of P by EI is equal to zero because this term becomes zero. Now from this equation, we can see that either B should be equal to zero or the sine L square root of B by EI is equal to zero. B cannot be zero because if B is zero, then there is no deflection. So what we can do is we can take the other term, that is sine L square root of P by EI is equal to zero. Or so for this sine zero, sine pi, sine two pi, sine three pi, etc., the equation is the value holds zero. So L into square root of P by EI is equal to zero, pi, two pi, three pi are the possible solutions. Now in this we are taking the least significant value, so that is L into square root of P by EI is equal to pi. And then I can write squaring on both the sides, L square P by EI is equal to pi square. Then I will get the equation, the Euler's equation, that is P is equal to pi square EI by L square. So Euler's crippling load for the first condition is given by pi square EI by L square. Similarly, so that means you need to design for the crippling load. You need to see that this load should be less than this value on the right side, or equal to or less than. Now coming to the second case, the same Euler's crippling load equation can be derived when both the ends are fixed. So in the diagram, you can see both the ends are fixed. Consider AB is a column, a long column AB of length L. The length is L here, and fixed at two ends, A and B. Let us take P as the critical load. Y is the deflection. You can see the deflection at the neutral axis. Y is the deflection. And then M is the moment at fixed ends. Now, if we apply the equation, if you write for bending moment, M at section XX, then it will be M minus P into Y. Okay, because M is the reaction developed at the ends, other end you can see. So M minus P into Y. So now we can write for this EI into d square over dx square equal to MP minus PY. Or further we can write taking d square y by dx square plus, so if I write, take the term on the right side, P by EIY is equal to MP by EIY. So bending moment at P is MP. So this equation is a differential equation. Let us call this equation number one. And we'll write the general solution for the differential equation, which is d square y by dx square plus p by EI into y is equal to mp by EI. The same equation written here. And the solution for this is y is equal to a cos x square root of p by EI plus b sin x square root of p by EI plus the term on the right side, mp by. So now here A and B are again the constant terms. To solve for this, we need to apply the boundary conditions. So applying the boundary conditions, at the ends there is no deflection. So slope is zero, hence dy by dx is also zero. So we can write now dy by dx is equal to minus A into square root of P by EI sine x square root of P by EI plus B into square root of P by EI cos X into square root of P by EI. So for if X is equal to zero, then slope is also equal to zero. That is dy by dx is equal to zero at ends. So substituting the value dy by dx is equal to zero, we can solve for the values here. A is, then from this equation, above equation, I can write zero is equal to B into square root of P by EI. Now, in this equation, P cannot be zero. So if load is zero, that is meaningless. So B can be equal to zero. So now that we have the value of B is equal to zero, if you substitute this one value, that is B is equal to zero, we have. Next, applying the second boundary condition, when X is equal to zero, Y is also equal to zero because there is no deflection at the ends. So if I substitute that, 0 is equal to A cos 0 plus 0 plus MP by P is equal to A plus MP by P. So that means we have A is equal to minus, if you take the term on the right side, that is A is equal to minus MP by P. So we have the values of B and A. So if I substitute this in equation Y is equal to, in place of A, I'll write minus MP by P cos L into square root of P by EI plus MP by P. And here B is equal to zero. So we'll get the equation. So now, again, when X is equal to L, Y is equal to zero. When X is total length, Y is deflection, at the end deflection is equal to zero. So substituting the value zero equal to minus MP by P cos L into square root of P by EI plus MP by. So from this equation, we can write 0 is equal to MP by P minus taking negative inside, minus cos L square root of P by EI plus L. MP by P is taken common here. That is minus cos L into square root of P by EI plus 1 is equal to 0. That is cos of this L into square root of P by EI is equal to 1. So this cos value is 1 for 0. Cos 0 is 1. 2 pi, it is 1, 4 pi, it is 1, etc. So then we can write, we'll consider the less lowest significant value here, and then considering the least significant value, that is L square root of P by EI is equal to 2 pi. So then if I square on both the sides, L square P by EI is equal to 4 pi square. From that, we'll get the Euler's crippling load when both ends are fixed, that is P is equal to 4 pi square EI by L square. So this is the Euler's critical load equation for the second condition when both the ends are fixed. Now let us go to the third derivation, that is Euler's crippling load for a column when one end is fixed and the other end is free. You can see here, this end is fixed, end A is fixed, and end B is free to deflect here. And the load applied here, due to the application of load, there is a deflection of the column through a deflection of Y at section XX. X is the distance of the neutral axis from one of the ends, and L is the length of the column. Consider a long column AB of length L fixed at one end and free at the other end. The column carries a load of P at end B. So Y is equal to deflection. A is the maximum deflection you can see here. A is the maximum deflection that can occur at end B. Now, if you write the bending moment equation here, bending moment M is equal to P into A minus YM. Okay. A out of A, if you subtract A, you will get this deflection. So P into A minus Y. The load P has a deflection through a distance A minus Y. Or if we write the further, EI into D square Y by DX square is equal to P into A minus Y. Or taking the terms on the rearranging, EI D square Y by DX square plus PY is equal to P into A. Or finally, we can write this equation in terms like this. D square Y by DX square plus P by EI into Y is equal to PA by EI. So for this equation, we can write the solution for the differential equation, which can be written as Y is equal to A cos X root P by EI plus B sin X root P by EI plus the term A, that is the deflection. So now here, the terms A and B are the constants. So to solve for these values, we need to apply the boundary conditions. So let us see here how the boundary conditions are applied. So you can see here, the boundary conditions are at fixed end A, the deflection or the slope is equal to zero. So dy by dx is equal to minus A into square root of P by EI, sine x into square root of P by EI plus B into square root of P by EI cos x into square root of P by EI. So here we apply the boundary condition. First one, that is when x is equal to 0, dy by dx is equal to 0, and at end slope is equal to 0. If you substitute the values, we'll get the value like this. So for this, we know that 0 is equal to B into square root of P by EI. So load cannot be equal to 0. Then hence B is equal to 0. So from this, applying the first boundary condition, we'll get the value of B as 0. Then second boundary condition, when X is equal to 0, Y is also equal to 0, no deflection. So applying Y is equal to 0, and A cos 0 plus 0 plus 0 is equal to, so B is already 0. If you substitute, then I can solve for the equation. So Y is equal to minus A cos X square root of P by EI plus A. So now, here further, we'll apply the third boundary condition, that is when x is equal to L, y is equal to A. At x is equal to maximum length, deflection is maximum, that is y is equal to A, that is at end B. So now substituting this value, so if I substitute A, deflection y is equal to A minus A cos square root of L into square root of P by EI plus A, or A cos. So this A and this A gets cancelled here. A cos L square root of P by EI is equal to 0, or cos L into square root of P by E is equal to 0. So the value of cos is 0 for pi by 2, 3 pi by 2, 5 pi by 2, or 7 pi by 2. So that means L by square root of P by EI is equal to, the least significant value is pi by 2, 90. So if I write this squaring on both the sides, L square P by EI is equal to pi square by 4. From that, I'll get the equation for the crippling load, that is P is equal to pi square EI by 4 L square. So that is for the third case. And finally, the fourth case, also we'll see the derivation. Euler's equation, Euler's crippling load for a column with one end fixed and the other end is pinned. So you can see here, one end is fixed here. This is the end fixed and other end is pinned. So now due to this, a moment is produced here, reaction. So we have a reaction force here. So consider a long column AB of length L, total length is L. And if we draw a section at the neutral axis XX, the deflection Y is the maximum deflection. And we can see now here you can see Y is the deflection, R is the reaction force that is developed here, and then M is the moment at end A. So now we can write the bending moment equation at end A, that is M is equal to MY into R into X minus P into Y. Okay, reaction into the distance X and load into distance Y. So our M is equal to R into L. So for M, we can write R into L minus R into X minus P into Y. So again, we can write this as EI d square Y by dx squared is equal to taking R common, L minus X minus P into Y. Or d square Y by dx squared plus P by EI into Y is equal to R into L minus X by EI. Now the general solution for this above equation, above differential equation, is Y is equal to A cos X into square root of P by EI plus B sin X into square root of P by EI plus R into L minus X by P, where A and B are the constants. Now applying the boundary condition, we can see that at end A, dy by dx, that is slope, is equal to zero. There is no deflection at the end. So we can write the equation, dy, differentiating equation y, dy by dx is equal to minus a into square root of p by ei sine x into square root of p by ei plus b into square root of p by ei plus cos x into square root of p by ei minus r by p. So this is the differentiation of the equation y. So once we get this equation for the slope, so we can apply the boundary condition. So we know that when x is equal to zero, dy by dx is zero because that slope is equal to zero. And now we can see that applying zero in this above equation, we'll get zero is equal to minus a into square root of p by ei sine zero plus b into square root of p by ei cos zero minus r by p. Or r by p value from this is b into square root of p by ei, or b is equal to r by p into square root of ei by p. So that is the value of b. So we have solved for the value b here by applying the first boundary condition. Now second boundary condition, when x is equal to zero, y is also zero at end A because deflection is zero. Substituting this value, y is equal to zero, equal to a cos zero plus r by p into square root of ei by p sin zero plus r into l minus zero by p. Or zero is equal to a and cos zero is one and this term becomes zero plus r l by p. So we'll get the value of a as minus r l by p. So substituting the values of both a, this a and b, so b is equal to r by p into square root of ei by p and A is equal to minus RL by P. Substituting this value in the equation of solution, Y is equal to minus R into L by P cos X square root of P by EI plus R by P square root of EI by P sine X square root of P by EI plus R into L minus X by P. So now we apply the third boundary condition, that is when X is equal to L, X is equal to total length L, Y is equal to zero. At hinged end, that is deflection is zero. Substituting that value also in this equation, y is equal to zero. So again, RL by P cos L into square root of P by EI plus R by P into square root of EI by P sine L square root of P by EI plus R into this L minus X by P. So now this further rearranging and simplifying the equation, we'll get the ratio of sine L into square root of P by EI by cos of L into square root of P by EI is equal to L into square root of P by EI. So that is sine by cos is tan here, tan inverse, if we take tan tan of square root of p by ei is equal to l into square root of p by ei. So cancelling the term, we'll get the value l into square root of p by ei is equal to 4.49. And squaring on the both the sides, l square by pi is equal to 2 pi square. And the equation for Euler's crippling load, that is p is equal to 2 pi square ei by l square, that is for the fourth condition. So these are the Euler's equations for crippling load for different end conditions.